This briefing on the proposed budget of the Office of the Vice President is now called to order. First, I would like to thank and recognize and acknowledge the presence of Vice President Sara Duterte and the entire OVP delegation. Good afternoon, guys. I'm sorry. Good afternoon. For orderly procedure, we begin with the presentation of the OVP. After that, we will open the floor for questions. Our tradition is to give preference to the Senate officers and then in order of arrival. I would like to acknowledge the presence of my colleague in today's budget briefing, Senator Villar, Senator Cynthia Villar, and of course, Senator Aimee Marcos. Puro mga babae ngayon yung present. So we will begin with a brief opening statement before we have a briefing. If you have any opening statement, none. Okay, we shall begin now with the briefing of the Office of the Vice President.
Thank you, Madam Chair. To our distinguished senators, good afternoon. I am pleased to introduce the members of the OVP delegation, Attorney Zulaika T. Lopez, Chief of Staff, Lemuel G. Ortonio, Assistant Chief of Staff. Please raise your hand so that they will know who you are. Attorney Rosalyn Sanchez, Director for Administrative and Financial Services Office. Attorney Sunshine Chari Fajarda, Director for Strategic Management Office. Norman Baloro, Director for Operations. Attorney Emily Rose Torrentira, Head Legal Affairs. Julieta Villa del Rey, Chief Accountant. Amard Ehe, Chief Disaster Operations Center. Maria Adeline Rabago, Officer in Charge, Budget Division. Colonel Raymond Dante Lachica, Vice President, Security and Protection Group. May I request the Secretariat to present our OVP? Thank you.
The Office of the Vice President's mission to deliver efficient, accessible, and responsive public service has already reached millions of Filipinos across the country. And the promise of a remarkable and meaningful impact is gleaned from the strength, hard work, and optimism shown by the individuals, groups, and communities being served by the OVP through its interventions that offer immediate and long-term solutions. These interventions were designed, developed, and implemented through the OVP's collaboration with various government agencies, local government units, private groups, people's organizations, and individual partners. The Office of the Vice President, the second highest government office in the Philippines, an institution for public service, an institution of nation building, an institution of change, stability, and progress. The OVP is an institution committed to the success of its programs and initiatives intended to create a lasting positive impact on the lives of Filipinos. Under the leadership of Vice President Sara Duterte, the Office of the Vice President has steadfastly worked to deliver essential social services across different regions of the country. The OVP is an active participant in the movement to achieve the nation's aspiration to have a prosperous, inclusive, and resilient future. We at the OVP continue to share in the noble mission of improving the quality of life of every Filipino family, especially those in the most underserved communities. We provide vital public assistance programs that ensure support, aid in the plight of the vulnerable sectors, and help alleviate the challenges of poverty in many communities. From January 2023 to July 2024, over 360 million pesos combined amount was successfully allocated to urgently address our people's pressing need for medical and burial assistance. A total amount of 364,383,041.87 pesos worth of medical assistance were provided to a total of 79,721 beneficiaries, while 99,240,000 pesos worth of burial assistance were given to 19,000 882 beneficiaries from various parts of the country. We have carried on in this tireless pursuit by rendering public assistance to thousands of Filipinos through OVP satellite offices in Luzon, Cagayan Valley, Pangasinan, and Bicol. In Visayas, Panay and Negros Islands, Eastern Visayas, and Cebu, Bohol, and Siquijor. And in Mindanao, Caraga, Western Mindanao, Southern Mindanao, and Barm, Bangsamoro Autonomous Region in Muslim Mindanao. In addition, two extension offices of the Public Assistance Division were also opened in Lipa, Batangas, and Tondo, Manila. Each satellite office and extension office across the country complement the functions of the central office in Robinson Cybergate Plaza in Mandaluyong. For fiscal year 2024, the OVP has a 1.885 billion peso available budget under the General Appropriations Act. As of June 30, 2024, the OVP has already obligated 40% of the allotment received, or equivalent to 826.605 million pesos, with a disbursement rate of 70% or 518.379 million pesos. In our goal of making sure that our people are afforded with safe, accessible, and secured commute, the Office of the Vice President has offered free transportation services to 414,734 Filipinos from January to June 2024. A total of 7 buses were deployed to transport passengers in Bacolod, Cebu, Davao, and Metro Manila. Following the recent calamity that has disrupted the lives of our people in Luzon and some parts of Visayas, we have also intensified our efforts to deliver immediate relief and assistance to affected communities. In adherence to our objective of saving lives and ensuring the utmost safety of all, 462,867 individuals and 134,168 families have benefited from the relief operations mobilized by our Disaster Operations Center from January to June 2024. A total of 58.3 million pesos were effectively allocated to various resource mobilization endeavors in support of all undertakings that aid OVPDOC's relief and rescue activities. We at the Office of the Vice President continue to rally behind the pursuit of environmental preservation while underscoring the value of education and oral health through the Pagbabago, a Million Learners and Trees campaign. The program is a two-pronged intervention of the Office of the Vice President to provide hope and encouragement to Filipino learners and champion care for our environment. From January 2023 to July 2024, we are pleased to say that over 300,000 trees were planted across many communities all over the country, while over 175,000 bags with dental kits and school supplies were distributed to thousands of young learners in many remote school communities. In ensuring adequate and sustained nutritional support to Filipino school children, the PAN Sarap program has provided a total of 1,216,510 PAN Sarap buns, which were distributed to several identified school communities in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. Our mission lies in our unwavering resolve to equip every young learner through nutrition, while leading them to a healthier future where they can actively nurture their growth potential. Aligning with the agenda of food security and sufficiency, we successfully initiated the distribution of rice bags and food packs to 36,260 Filipino families and individuals who are facing the challenges of hunger and food insecurity. The RISE program of the Office of the Vice President is conducted to extend immediate relief and provide necessary support to our disadvantaged Filipinos under difficult situations. We reiterate our goal of helping our people realize their hopes for better quality of life by paving avenues that urgently address their most pressing needs. Likewise, we remain committed to our mission to promote socio-economic development among women and members of the LGBTQ plus communities by providing livelihood and employment opportunities to the qualified recipients of Magnegosyo Tadhai program. From January 2023 to July 2024, a total of 1,965,000 worth of livelihood assistance was successfully granted to 50 qualified recipients. They will also undergo technical and financial management training to ensure the success of their projects. We also continue in our resolve to uphold the value of transformational and servant leadership among the Filipino youth through the You Can Be VP program by promoting immersive opportunities that present the intricacies of governance and policy formulation. We hope that we can inspire them to become equipped and exemplary students with a genuine regard for their nation's welfare. Covering the period of January 2023 to June 2024, 255 local and international engagements were attended by the Office of the Vice President to show support and express our gratitude for the commendable socio-civic and development efforts undertaken by various organizations in the public and private sector. For 2025, the recommended budget for OVP is 2.37 billion pesos, an 8.05 increase compared to the current year appropriation amounting to 1.885 billion pesos. This proposal, once approved, will enable the OVP to continue the operations of the satellite offices and extension offices. It will also ensure the success of the expanded OVP's social services. Hand in hand, we will usher in innovation, carry on transformative progress, and shape a more prosperous future for our people, our communities, and our country. The OVP shares the hopes, aspirations, and dreams of the Filipinos, and we at the OVP take pride that it is an institution that puts the welfare of the Filipinos at the heart of its mission. The OVP commits to lead, serve, uplift, and empower the Filipinos. Ang tanggapan ng pangalawang pangulo ng Pilipinas, pamumunuan, paglilingkuran, aalalayan ang mga Pilipino. Lagi kaming tapat sa bayan.
We request Maria Edlyn Rabago, the OIC of the Budget Division, to present the salient points of the OVP budget for fiscal year 2025.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, and to the members of the committee. Presenting the highlights and salient features of the FY 2025 proposed budget of the Office of the Vice President. Under the FY 2025 National Expenditure Program, the Department of Budget and Management has recommended a budget of 2.037 billion pesos vis-a-vis the 3.24 billion proposal of the Office of the Vice President. The amount recommended is 8.05% higher than the FY 2024 budget as appropriated. This composed of the following. The recommended personal services budget for FY 2025 is 9.25% of the total recommended budget. It covers 149 field positions, special duty allowance for military and uniformed personnel, salary for non-permanent positions. It also includes provision for terminal leave benefits of mandatory retirees, loyalty award and anniversary bonus for OVP personnel. The total personal services including the RLIF for FY 2025 is 188.514 million pesos. Recommended MOOE or the maintenance and other operating expenses for FY 2025 is equivalent to 1.792 billion pesos. Significant portion of the total MOOE is allocated for the financial assistance or subsidies and supplies and materials or welfare goods, which account for 52.86% and 15.92% of the total MOOE. The MOOE is 87.98% of the total budget. The total capital outlay is 2.77% of the total recommended budget. This covers the procurement of motor vehicles in relation to the ceremonial, diplomatic, and advocacy-based engagements of the Office of the Vice President. It also includes ICT equipment and various machineries and equipment. By appropriation source, 2.026 billion or 99.5% is under the agency-specific and 0.05% is under the retirement and life insurance benefits. The appropriated budget of the OVP beginning 2019 is above 500 million. It has been consistently increasing since then, and under the current year appropriation, the OVP has 1.885 billion pesos. While the appropriation is consistently increasing, the obligation rate remained in good standing and maintained the rate at above 90%. The DBM recommended the budget of 2.037 billion for fiscal year 2025 vis-a-vis the 3.24 billion proposal, which is 8.05% higher than the FY 2024 budget as appropriated due to the expansion of the socio-economic services of the Office of the Vice President, which was proposed under Tier 2. Of the total OVP proposed budget, 1.269 billion or 62% is allotted for the socio-economic programs of the OVP. As the second highest office in the land, the OVP aims to promote the welfare of every Filipino in line with its vision to create lasting impact on the lives of every Filipino through its socio-economic programs and services. With this, the OVP established satellite offices and extension offices in key areas in Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao to provide Filipinos with immediate access to the services offered by the OVP. In 2023, we were able to cater to 977,615 beneficiaries out of the 670,300 target, and as of June 30 this year, we have served 684,830 out of the 1,013,620 target beneficiaries. And for 2025, we target to cater 1,139,244 beneficiaries. For the fiscal year 2023, we have 977,615 total beneficiaries of all OVP services delivered, 793 strategic partnership established or strengthened, 98% of requests acted upon within standard processing time, 100% of projects with partners implemented as planned, 97% average satisfaction ratings for OVP services, and 489 ceremonial engagements completed. As to financial performance, out of the 2.447 billion pesos allotment, we have obligated 2.259 billion pesos with an obligation rate of 92%. And we have disbursed 2.096 billion pesos with a disbursement rate of 93%. As of June 30 of this year, we have 684,830 beneficiaries of all OVP services delivered, 287 strategic partnership established or strengthened, 98.8% of requests acted upon within standard processing time, 98.7% of projects with partners implemented as planned, 97.3% average satisfaction ratings of OVP services, and 255 ceremonial engagements completed. As to financial performance of the first semester of the fiscal year 2024, out of the 2.072 billion pesos allotment, we have obligated 826.6 million pesos with obligation rate of 40% and disbursed 518.379 million with a disbursement rate of 70%. As the second highest office in the land, the OVP carries out functions that complements work of other government agencies while advancing the well-being of the Filipino people, with a mission to deliver efficient, accessible, and responsive public services, our work resonates at the core of our nation's welfare and progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ma'am Adeline. Madam Chair, the OVP is ready to accept questions.
Before we open the floor for questions, Senator Bato de la Rosa would like to give an opening statement.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to express my utmost support for the proposed budget of the Office of the Vice President for fiscal year 2025 under the leadership of our esteemed Vice President Sara Duterte. Government service is making the most out of what little resources an office may possess. It is about finding ways to promote the general welfare of the people, however limiting or restricting the circumstances are. The OVP can only do so much with its annual budget, but it has set a good example to other government offices and agencies in maximizing funds. Vice President Sara Duterte could have just stood by and done nothing, but she chose a more proactive role in furthering the noble cause of Bangon Pilipinas, which is inclusivity in achieving economic and social growth. I have full confidence that the leadership of our Vice President is guided by her deep commitment to unite a country whose political landscape is constantly beset by indivision. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Bato. Senator Bongo will now give his opening statement.
Magandang araw po sa ating lahat, no? Just want to express my support for the proposed budget of the Office of the Vice President for the year 2025. As a proud Daboenyo, I have witnessed firsthand the remarkable work of VP Inday Sara Duterte. I can attest to the positive impact she has made on every community and the entire nation. Sa mga nakaraang taon, nagkaroon po ang OVP ng mga programang nagbibigay ng tunay na benepisyo po sa ating mga kababayan, from medical assistance to relief operations, educational support, pangkabuhayan programs, at libreng sakay, among others. In fact, the libreng sakay program has already served more than 638,000 passengers in Metro Manila, Bacolod, Cebu, and Davao in 2023 alone. Naalala ko po, meron pong pinahiram po sa akin na bus noong 2019 at ngayon po ay pinahiram rin po ito sa OVP at para po mas marami pang mga kababayan nating commuters ang makikinabang sa programang libreng sakay. In addition, we recently supported the Office of the Vice President to further augment its free bus rides. May ruta na po ito mula sa PITX hanggang Naic, Cavite at operational na po ito August 14. Malaking tulong po ito sa ating mga commuters dahil ang pamasaheng may titipid po nila, 90 pesos hanggang 100 pesos. Bawat piso po ay napakahalaga po ito sa ating mga kababayang Pilipino, lalo-lalo po yung mga mahirap nating kababayan. Ang programang ito ay tunay na nakakatulong sa pagpapagaan ng kanilang araw-araw na pamumuhay, kaya mas lalo pa po dapat natin itong suportahan. At we laud the calamity and disaster response of the OVP, which helped provide immediate relief assistance to more than 100,000 families affected by floods, fire, earthquake, among others. Muli, nais ko pong ihayag ang aking buong suporta po sa budget ng Office of the Vice President. Maraming salamat po, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Bongo. I would like to recognize Senator Jinggoy Estrada for his opening.
Thank you, Madam Chair. The Office of the Vice President has been an active partner of various government agencies in providing vital services to our Kababayan, thus fulfilling its mandate to improve their lives and livelihood. Through the various programs that the OVP implements, our countrymen in the marginalized sector are empowered to become contributors to our nation's progress. For the year 2025, the OVP will implement two new programs that aim to promote education and health. One of the programs is the Educational Assistance Program, which will reach out to the poor, marginalized, vulnerable, and disadvantaged families. Another one is the Wheelchair Program, which will cater to individuals in need of wheelchairs. I am certain that these programs will greatly benefit our people. Sa katunayan, ito rin po ang madalas na idinudulog sa aming tanggapan dito sa Senado at ikinagalak namin na maglulunsad ng Office of Vice President ng mga programa upang tugunan ito. Maraming salamat po sa ating butihing pangalawang Pangulo, Vice President Sara Zimmerman Duterte, sa kanyang mapagmahal na paglilingkod sa ating mga kababayan. Marami po ang umaasa sa mga programang yon inyong pinatutupad at dahil dito ay patuloy namin susuportahan ang pagbibigay ng sapat na pondo upang may pagpatuloy ninyo ang mga ito at makatulong sa mas marami pa natin mga kababayan. Madam Chair, I would like to manifest my steadfast support for the approval of the proposed 2025 budget of the Office of the Vice President. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Senator Jinggoy. Senator Amy Marcos, are you, or Senator Cynthia Villar, do you have any opening?
I just want to manifest my full support for the budget of the Vice President. Thank you.
No introductory statements thus far, but from what I've seen, I think the limited budget of the Office of the Vice President is an illustration that budgetary restraint should not serve as limitations in performing, but should inspire other government offices to be more innovative and to have more initiative. So it should be an illustration of how we should really deliver services to the people. So thank you, the Office of the Vice President. I am here to show my full support to the immediate passage of the budget of the Office of the Vice President. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Tolentino. I'd like to acknowledge the presence of my colleagues here today. I think I've only acknowledged two. I should acknowledge also Senator Tolentino, Senator Bongo, earlier Senator Bato, Senator Jinggoy Estrada, and now Senator Risa Hontiveros. Well, it's supposed to be Senator Amy, but then she doesn't really. Okay, then Senator Risa is now recognized. She's just catching her breath because she came from two other obligations. One is the Commission on Appointments and another hearing. Thank you.
Salamat po, Chair, at magandang hapon po sa lahat, mga kasama ko sa Senado at yung OVP family. Dalawang tanong lang po, Chair, para ngayong araw. Una po, I note that a huge chunk of the OVP's 2025 operations budget, 1.909 billion pesos, will be used for the delivery of socio-economic programs such as 1. Medical and Burial Assistance Program. This supplements other healthcare programs of the government to assist indigent individuals and families. For 2025, 771.445 million will be allocated for the program. Sa loob niyan, 600 million pesos for medical assistance and 171.445 million for burial assistance, which are, Madam Chair, very similar to the medical assistance to indigent or financially incapacitated patients program or MAIF-IP of the DOH. And DSWDs, Assistance for Individuals in Crisis Situations, or AICS. Pangalawa, Disaster Operations, which aims to provide relief goods to disaster-stricken areas not commonly reached by other agencies. Para doon, 101.644 million pesos. And is also similar doon naman sa Disaster Risk Management Program of the DSWD. Third, Relief for Individuals in Crisis and Emergencies, or providing food boxes or food items to families who are ineligible for OVP's other services. So 50 million pesos, which is also similar to DSWD's AICS. And last, Magnegosyo Taday, Livelihood Assistance for Those with Entrepreneurial Skills, 150 million pesos, which is also similar to DOLES naman, Integrated Livelihood Program o DLIP. So, ang tanong ko po dito, Madam Chair, anong nag-lead sa OVP na mag-consider na i-launch yung ganitong programs? May ginawa bang studies para suportahan yung pagkakaroon ng ganitong programs na parallel naman sa katulad at existing programs ng iba't iba nating line agencies, Madam Chair?
Yes, Madam Chair. Thank you. Noong ako po ay nangampanya, tatlo lang po yung sinabi ko na plataforma. Una po, trabaho. Pangalawa po, edukasyon. At tatlo, mapayapang pamumuhay para sa ating mga mamamayan. Nung pumasok po kami sa Office of the Vice President, tiningnan po namin ang mga pinakamaraming requests ng ating mga kababayan. Una-una po, ang lagi po naming natatanggap na request ay medical and burial assistance. Pangalawa po ay financial assistance. Pangatlo, lagi silang humihingi ng tulong sa pagkain. At pang-apat, very recently, sa tali ng mga requests, no? Yes, sa tali ng mga requests is yung educational assistance na sinasabi ng mga kababayan natin. Sinasabi namin lagi sa kanila, libre naman yung public schools. Ngayon ay libre na rin yung higher educational institutions. Pero sinasabi nila nahihirapan kasi sila sa plete, nahihirapan sila sa pabaon ng mga bata at sa pagkain ng mga bata. Kaya meron kaming bago, ito yung educational assistance. At ang panghuli naman, lagi naming natatanggap na request galing sa ating mga kababayan ay kapag sila ay naging biktima ng disaster, whether man-made or natural disasters. So sila po ay lumalapit sa Office of the Vice President. Totoo po, merong mga ibang local government units at ibang national government agencies na ganito po ang kanilang programa. Pero po, nung ako ay umupo as a vice president, I took an oath, and doon sa oath, I said that I will do justice to every man. So hindi po kami pwedeng humindi sa mga tao na humihingi ng tulong, lalong-lalo na ay kaparte ng gobyerno ang Office of the Vice President.
Salamat, VP, Madam Chair. Sabi nga ng VP, Madam Chair, libre na yung public school, libre na rin yung higher education, bagamat ninote nila na sinasabi ng mga nagre-request na nahihirapan pa rin sila sa ilang mga programs na nakalodge sa ilalim ng libreng edukasyon na iyan. Kaya nga kinonsider nilang mag-launch ng ganitong mga katulad na programs. Iko-consider ba ng VP na i-lodge na lang yung mga budgets nitong mga programa doon na lang sa mga line agencies natin? Tapos mag-request na lang ang OVP ng allocation para in sync sa priorities ng executive department sa halip na magkaroon pa ng hiwalay pero magkatulad naman na programa, Madam Chair.
Madam Chair, we only submit the budget and we leave it to the discretion of all the members of Congress to decide on the budget. We can only propose a budget for the Office of the Vice President. Pero magbibigay po ako ng halimbawa kung ganun po ang gagawin natin. Tulad po ng AICS ng DSWD. Kapag meron po kaming nire-refer o binibigyan ng endorsement ng AICS sa DSWD, kadalasan po nasagot sa amin ay hindi pwede dahil galing yan sa Office of the Vice President at kalaban yan. Minsan po, totoo yan na pupolitika ang assistance para sa ating mga kababayan. Kaya po, uulitin ko, ang mga tao naman kasi hindi sila tumitingin sa politika. Tumitingin lang sila na itong opisina na ito ay opisina ng gobyerno at pwede kaming humingi ng tulong doon. And so I go back to the oath that I shall do justice to every man, at kaya po kami nandito at kaya po kami merong mga ganito na mga projects sa Office of the Vice President.
Salamat VP, Madam Chair. Wini-welcome ko yung sinabi nila na the VP would leave it to the discretion of the members of Congress. Medyo nagitla ako nung sinabing minsan pag may nire-refer ang OVP para sa AICS, ang feedback ay kalaban niyan. Dahil Madam Chair, I believe tayo sa Kongreso when we appropriate the budget, merong implicit na assumption tayo doon na pagkatapos, in the exercise of our oversight function, yung parehong level ng professionalism we demand of ourselves ay resumption of regularity, ina-expect natin sa lahat ng members ng executive, lalo na when they are working together. Kaya, gaya ng sinabi ko kanina, wini-welcome ko yung sinabi ni VP na they would leave it to the discretion of the members of Congress, and tayo naman ay hindi tayo bibitaw sa mahigpit nating pag-ensure na these programs be implemented by the appropriate agencies o kahit in collaboration with each other na naaayon talaga sa tamang standards above partisan politics. And therefore, at the proper time, Madam Chair, gagawa ako ng proper motion para i-lodge yung budgets ng mga programang ito sa line agencies na may klarong opportunity for OVP na mag-request for allocation as for other offices in the executive. Yung huling tanong ko sa ngayon, Madam Chair, for 2025, one of the OVP's programs, Pagbabago Campaign, A Million Learners Entries, involves the provision of bags to 1 million learners in remote communities while initiating tree planting activities. This gets an appropriation of 100 million pesos. Part of this campaign is an allocation of 10 million pesos for the distribution of Isang Kaibigan Books, a children's book authored by the VP. Pwede po bang sabihin ni VP sa atin? More tungkol sa librong ito.
Chair, let me make a rebuttal and another example of politicizing the budget of the government. Ito pong sinabi ni Senator Risa Ontiveros na at the proper time she'll make a motion to lodge the budget, the requested budget of the OVP to the other agencies. Let me just quote Senator Risa during the Akbayan Congress. Alam ko po na ang daming kalat ni Duterte na hirap tayong linisin. Ang kadiliman noong panahon niya ay talaga namang nanuot sa ating lipunan para mansa na napakahirap tanggalin. At habang ang anak niya ay may kapangyarihan pa, hindi magiging madali ang ating laban. While VP Sara is in power, the threat of a full-blown Duterte comeback is still a very real and present danger. For one, they are supported by one major superpower, China. So that is an example of politicizing the budget of the government. May we request, Madam Chair, that Senator Risa Ontiveros repeat the last question?
I will certainly, if you request, Madam Chair, repeat my question dahil walang kinalaman sa kasasabi lang ng VP ngayon. Alam nating lahat na miyembro ng iba't ibang partido, yung speeches natin sa ating mga kamiyembro sa mga party congresses ay hiwalay na event dito sa budget debates. So I really take exception dun sa sinabi ni VP na rebuttal iyan dahil halimbawa ito sa politicizing. In fact, wala akong tinanong tungkol sa China o kahit sino pa mang ibang bansa dito sa budget hearing na to. I am asking about yung national budget na ipapasa natin sa Kongreso para sa bansang Pilipinas sa taong 2025. At ang pangalawang at huling tanong ko sa ngayon, before I make at the proper time, propose an amendment which may or may not be accepted by the chair and by the colleagues para nga mas i-align ang mga kaperahan natin, lalo na't masikip ang fiscal space natin dun sa mga appropriate programs sa appropriate agencies na malayang malaya ang OVP makipag-partner sa kanila tulad ng sino pang opisina sa executive. Ang tanong ko po ay ilang mga libro ng Isang Kaibigan ay bibilihin at i-distribute at ano, if the VP could tell us more about the contents ng librong ito. Madam Chair.
Madam Chair, the book is not for sale. We only pay for the publication of the book. And we will send Senator Ontiveros a copy so that she will know what is the content of the book.
This question is not only for me, Madam Chair, para rin para sa mga kasama dito sa budget hearing. Baka ilang araw pa bago mapadala at mabasa ko, which I certainly will. But I am asking a question bilang isang mambabatas sa head of agency ng isang opisina sa executive dito sa budget hearing na to. Simpleng tanong. Tell us more about the book, isang kaibigan, at ilang kopya nito ang bibilihin ng gobyerno sa halagang 10 milyong piso at i-distribute sa kasama ng mga bag sa 1 million learners sa remote communities, Madam Chair.
Madam Chair, this is an example of politicizing the budget hearing through the questions of a senator. Ang problema niya kasi, nakalagay yung pangalan ko doon sa libro. At yung libro na yan, ibibigay namin doon sa mga bata. At yung mga bata na yan, may mga magulang na boboto. At yung pangalan ko ay nagkalat doon sa kung saan man ibibigay yung libro. Madam Chair, we commit to send tomorrow everyone in this room a copy of the book.
Madam Chair, hindi ko maintindihan yung ugali ng ating resource person. It is a simple question. Paulit-ulit na this is politicizing. Ang VP ang nagbanggit ng salitang boboto. Wala akong sinabing boboto. I'm simply asking, hindi ko ma-imagine we're making so much trouble, so much fuss about a 10 million peso item na itinatanong ko lang simpleng what is the book about? At ilang kopya ang bibilihin ng gobyerno sa halagang 10 milyong piso at i-distribute. I don't appreciate this kind of attitude, Madam Chair. Usually, ang resource persons natin ay nagbibigay ng parehong institutional courtesy sa legislature na ibinibigay natin sa executive. I don't appreciate this kind of attitude.
Senator Delgino, do you have a...
Madam Chair. Yes, Madam Chair. Hindi ko rin maintindihan ang ugali ni Senator Risa Ontiveros. And I do not appreciate... Ano yung sinabi niya? I do not appreciate this kind of behavior and attitude. Madam Chair, noong 2016, tumatakbo si Senator Risa Ontiveros na senator, nakailang talo na siya. So,
dalawa, Madam Chair.
Okay, dalawa. Natatakot siya sa pangatlong talo niya, kaya pumunta siya sa Davao. Humingi siya ng tulong. Tinulungan siya ng isang kagawad ng Davao na ngayon hindi na siya sinusuportahan. Humingi siya ng tulong sa akin, thinking na hindi mananalo si President Rodrigo Duterte. Kinausap niya ako ng kinausap doon sa law office ko sa Davao City. Sabi ko sa kanya, sige, tutulungan kita. Chinika niya ako ng chinika. Tapos umalis siya. Siyempre, hindi naman siya tumutulong kay Pangulong Duterte. Hindi din totoo yung sinabi ko na tutulungan kita. Tinext niya ako. Pwede ba akong mag-follow up sa hinihingi kong tulong sa boto dyan sa Davao City? So sabi ko sa kanya, okay, sige. So tinawagan ko at sinabihan ko at pinakiusapan ko ng pinakiusapan si former Congressman Milen Garcia. Sabi ko sa kanya, kung tulungan mo ito, bigyan mo na lang ng ilang barangay mo at ilang mga leaders mo. Ayaw pa siya tulungan ni former Congressman Milen Garcia. Pinakiusapan ko ulit, Kong, please tulungan mo na lang. Nanalo na siya at nung nanalo siya, anong ginawa niya? Siya ang pinakaunang umatake kay President Rodrigo Duterte. Anong tawag sa ugaling ganito?
With due respect to our resource persons and also our colleagues, I think this doesn't really, I understand there's history among all of us here, but I think that we should really stick to the budget. And I think this is just being very objective. I would like to ask also, since we're going to be furnished a copy tomorrow, we can look at it and evaluate what the content of the book is. But maybe just a general, we won't ask line by line, ano ba yung libro na yan. But tell me, is it for good manners and right conduct, that's fine. Is it science? Is it history? So maybe just a general one, so we can just answer it. Because I understand that every office will have its own advocacy and initiative. So, but then, I don't think it's also wrong for us to be curious what it is about. So just a general one. Any of the undersecretaries can tell me what the topic of the book is. Is it history? Is it, what is it?
Madam Chair, the explanation is in the title, Isang Kaibigan. It's about friendship.
Okay. Then that's for the record. It's about friendship.
Madam Chair, just a last point.
Okay.
So kung sana ganun yung naging sagot sa simula pa, di ba? Napakasimple. Simpleng tanong, dapat simpleng sagot. Nagkwento pa ng kwento na sinabi dati na walang kinalaman sa tanong ko. Just for the record, as a last point, Madam Chair, this is public funds and we're making inquiries about them. Budget hearing po ito. Hindi po lahat about you. Pero po ito ng taong bayan.
Okay, okay.
For the record, Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam
personal,
Chair.
But I understand the emotion is high. But let's continue on. If you have any more questions, Senator Risa, we will
Those are just my two questions, Madam Chair. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you. Senator Tolentino, you had your hand raised earlier.
I was about to ask for a minute suspension of the hearing, but since the good chairperson of this committee already gave her guidance on what and how this budget hearing should proceed, I defer to the wisdom of the chairperson.
Thank you. I would like to acknowledge the presence of Senator Bong Revilla and Senator Robin Hood Padilla. Thank you. Anybody else? Senator Mark Villar as well. And Senator Allen, and Senator Allen Cayetano. Any more questions?
Yes.
Senator Aimee Marcos, you are recognized.
Yes, samantalang nasimulan na ang pagtatanong tungkol sa budget, nais kong bigyan ng pagkakataon ng pangalawang pangulo na sumagot sa mga pumupuna sa kanya at laging binabanggit ang mga COA report ng 2022-2023 na mababa daw ang implementasyon at kulang daw ang internal controls at guidelines. May masasabi po ba tayo tungkol dito? May kasagutan po ba ito?
Madam Chair, yes, we call on Attorney Rosaline Sanchez to answer the question.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. On the first question on the low implementation of some of the programs, Your Honor, some of the programs were just started to be implemented by the office in 2023. We are still in the process of fine-tuning the details of the program and obtaining the requirements from the applicants of the programs. Specifically on the Magnegosyo Taday project, we have seen that some of our target beneficiaries have difficulty in complying with the requirements, and we are closely working with the Commission on Audit to streamline the process for the application of the program. And on the controls, on the matter of controls, Madam Chair, we would like to know that we have not received, we would like to know that audit findings are still not yet final, and we are again working closely with COA to improve our processes and address the issues that they have raised during the audit, Madam Chair.
Madam Chair, I am Attorney Lopez, the Chief of Staff of the Office of the Vice President. As regards the first question on the matter of the low implementation rate of the Office of the Vice President, for the past 2 years, Your Honor, for year 2022 and 2023, as we have presented early on, the Office of the Vice President has a 92% utilization rate, actually. But it is, as of June, July, the rate is stands at 40%, primarily because most of our programs are rolled out towards the second semester, particularly, for example, the Pagbabago Bag in time for the opening of the school year. school year, and also the launch of our Pansara program, which we will also be launching upon school opening. So this is a big bulk of the budget of the Office of the Vice President. Hence, there is a low utilization rate. But at the end of the year, all of this, Madam Chair, as we have as records will bear out, it will be around the 90 to 92% utilization rate.
Yes, congratulations. So that therefore, those who say that the same observations have been made by COA for the past 2 years are inaccurate and unaware of the actions already taken by the OVP. Is that correct?
Ma'am, the matter of the low, it is correct as regards the matter of the first semester, because we really do have a low reutilization rate for even for the past years as regards the first semester. But
the repeated observation from COA is regards to the inadequate guidelines processes and the lack of internal control. Yun ang naulit ng dalawang taon. Na isaayos na ba yan? Kasi nabanggit ni attorney na kausap na ninyo yung COA at ginagawa na ng guidelines na sapat.
That is correct, Your Honor. We are working continuously with the team from the Commission on Audit to improve and streamline our processes and guidelines.
Nakakatuwa yung budget ninyo. Nautangan pa kayo ng CHED. Nabayaran na ba kayo ng 18 million na utang?
Your Honor, if I may answer the question. Okay. Your Honor, there it was partial liquidation by CHED from the time that we had our budget hearing last year until this year. But there is still a remaining amount of 1,993,500 pesos, Your Honor, out of the original 18 million.
Hindi kayo nag-iisa. Ang CHED may utang din sa mga senador. Kaya yun ang nakakatuwa sa CHED kung saan-saan napupunta yung pera. At wala na po akong tanong. Ang sasabihin ko lang, talagang hindi naman sa barangay lamang napupulitika yung ayuda, pati dito sa mga senador, pati sa ating pangalawang Pangulo.
Senator Alan Cayetano is now recognized.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. Madam Vice President, magandang hapon po and welcome to the Senate. Magandang tanghali. I'd like to note that this committee is ruled by the women and kaming mga men ay nasa sidelines lang. I'd also like to note that although as a senator, naintindihan ko si Senator Risa na siyempre mas gusto kong cordial yung sagutan. But we also have to take into context that this is both legislative and political. And there are attacks against the Vice President regardless saan nanggagaling. So, a little bit of latitude dahil we want kakampi man o kalaban to feel welcome. But I agree with Senator Risa naman na, how do we make it more cordial? No? So, Madam Vice President, may I ask just one question? Actually, two eh. One, nag-lunch na po ba kayo? And,
yes, Senator Cayetano, nag-lunch na po ako. And I'm very cordial,
yes,
when it
ma'am.
Comes to international diplomatic relations. Gusto niyo i-discuss natin yung West Philippine Sea.
Yes.
But hindi kasi ako plastic na tao.
No, I agree with you, ma'am. That's why nga sinasabi ko po na hindi lang to legislative, political din. That's why you should be given the latitude to answer in the way that you feel it could be properly answered, di ba? So the other, kaya ko lang tinanong kung nag-lunch kayo kasi in the first 2 years, I know that you got a very warm welcome sa Senate. So I'm hoping sa budget hearing it doesn't change, no? I remember ang daming pumunta sa lunch noon. So my question lang, ma'am, is what can we do for the Office of the Vice President? Meron bang ni-request sa DBM na wala sa budget niyo so that we can consider it at the proper time?
No, we are already okay with the approved budget from the Department of Budget. The approved proposed budget in the NEP from the Department of Budget and Management. And we leave it up to members of Congress to decide on the budget. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you to the Office of the Vice President.
Any more questions? Well, so it's always the chair that has the last spot for questions. So let me just ask, of course, the security of every government official is very important. And recently, it was discussed that a number of security personnel was taken out from the office of the vice president. I think, if I'm not mistaken, totally, the PNP said they recalled 373 personnel across all agencies. So I'd like to know, baka naman wala nang natirang security sa OVP, hindi naman, ano na bang status? Ilan ang tinanggal na security at meron bang nagbabantay ngayon?
Madam Chair, may I be allowed to give a very long answer about the security?
Sure, as long as it answers the question.
Sige, ma'am. Opo. Noong kasi ako ay nahalal bilang pangalawang pangulo, nakita ko kasi na pati ang security ng Vice President ay napupulitika. Hindi lang yan sa akin, kundi sa mga previous na Vice Presidents. Kaya nung tapos na ang eleksyon pero hindi pa ako naupo, sumulat ako kay former Secretary Delphine Lorenzana. Sinabi ko sa kanya, "Sir, ang security ng Vice President should only be up to the level of the Vice President. Hindi po pwede na umakyat ang information at ang security ng Vice President sa iba pang opisyal." And at the time, the Chief of Staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines and the Secretary of the Department of National Defense agreed. That's why on June 2022, ito yung sa Armed Forces of the Philippines. On June 2022, the Secretary SND wrote to the Chief of Staff of the AFP, "From Vice Presidential Security Detachment under the PSG, Secretary Lorenzana ordered the Vice President Security and Protection Group, which is a separate entity from the PSG." So ito yung June 22, 2022. Ngayon, nag-issue ng orders ang AFP GHQ ng General Order 0917 to activate the reorganization from detachment to security group on July 5, 2022, the activation order and the table of organization and equipment was released. Yes. All right. So, hindi ko alam kung ano ang nangyari sa Philippine National Police, but apparently they decided that they will mirror what the AFP did. So, noong December 9, 2022, inactivate ang Vice Presidential Protection Division under the PSPG. Ito under ng NHQ General Order OPL 22-22 and NAPOLCOM Resolution 2022-0675. Kaya po mali yung sinasabi ng lahat, hindi lang ako nagsasalita, ngayon lang ako nabigyan ng opportunity na magsalita. Hindi po tama na ikumpara yung term ni Vice President Lenny Robredo at yung term ko in terms of security. Dahil yung security, yung VPSPG at yung VPPD sa PNP ay meron pong orders lahat. Ibig sabihin, there is a basis in law doon sa pag-activate sa kanila. Ngayon, yung sa Philippine National Police, kinuha nila ang 75 na personnel. Sila ang pumili kung sino yung kukunin nila. Makikita nyo, as I said during my statement, it was a targeted list. Madami doon sa mga security na yon. Security is a trust and confidence position. Kasi ibibigay mo sa kanila yung kanang pagsalig nimo sa imuhang kinabuhi, ihatag na nimo sa ilaha. Ngayon, Nakalagay doon sa listahan, kasama ko since 2007 when I was vice mayor, kasama ko since 2010 when I was mayor, and madami doon kasama ko from 2016 during the term for 6 years of President Rodrigo Duterte. Makikita nyo yon sa listahan kung isa-isahin natin. So it was a targeted list. It was a political move. It was political harassment. Ngayon, nag-iwan sila ng 38. 38 na hindi namin kilala. 38 na sila ang nagsabi kung sino ang maiwan. Sinulatan namin sila, sinabi namin, hindi na namin tatanggapin yung 38 ninyo. Ibabalik na namin yan sila lahat sa inyo. So there are no more PNP personnel in the office of the Vice President. Ang naiwan na lang ay yung mga nasa VP, SPG under the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Wala pong ginagastos ang OVP sa sweldo nito nila lahat dahil hindi po sila hinahire. Personnel na po sila ng ating AFP na dinidetail papunta sa Office of the Vice President. So, to answer your question, Madam Chair, meron pong security and all of them under AFP because we refused the personnel na sinabi. Ito na naman tayo kay General Marbil. Na sinabi niya, ibabalik niya kapag mag-request kami. Sinulatan nila kami na mag-request kayo kasi ibabalik namin. Hindi ko gagawin yan.
Thank you, Madam Vice President. So right now, your security detail is composed of AFP officers, I mean soldiers, I suppose.
Yes, Madam Chair, officers and enlisted personnel.
Mga ilan kaya sila?
May we request Colonel Lechica to answer?
Nakakagulat din yung statement ng PNP. Para, well, I guess he wants it on his record, but I find it a little also irregular na you're right, it's a trust issue. And if you're familiar with certain individuals, they have to explain why they, I mean, maybe in the budget hearing of the PNP, we can ask them why they chose the individuals to remove from your detail. But I'd like to know also how many is left from the AFP. And I think the AFP is also quite capable. Ilan po, Mr. Lechica?
Madam Chair, good afternoon. I think I cannot disclose the number, but I have here our activation order and our table of organization.
Why can't you not disclose the number?
For security reasons, ma'am.
Well, okay. I will.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Sabihin mo na, sir.
From our table of organization, ma'am, and equipment, we are authorized to have 364. Personnel coming from the different major service of the AFP, but for our actual number as of now, 337 po, ma'am.
And this is under the AFP, and this doesn't come from the budget of the OVP? Or...
Yes, Madam Chair.
Okay, thank you very much. That's all. Any more questions? Senator Bato de la Rosa is recognized.
Ma'am, I just would like to inform this committee that during our last hearing with my committee on public order and dangerous drugs, that issue was raised. And I told the Chief PNP, General Marbil, na hindi na nire-request ng Office of the Vice President na ibalik yung tinanggal niya ng mga pulis. Kung pwede lang, ibalik sa kanilang pinanggalingan na unit. Hindi yung, ito mga kawawa ito, mga taga-Davao ito na been serving there for how many years. Tapos dinislocate nila, nilagay nila Region 4 in CRPO, malayo sa pamilya. So ang request na lang namin, ako bilang Davaoino, na-request ko lang sa kanya, maawa ka naman dyan sa mga pulis na yan. Ibalik mo doon sa kanila pinanggalingan. Kung taga-Davao City yan, taga-Davao Oriental, taga-Kumbal, taga-Cotabato, ibalik mo na yan doon. And he promised me na ibalik daw niya. I don't know until now because hindi ko pa alam kung anong nangyari sa usapan namin. Yun lang, para lang mabalik yung mga pulis yan kahit na hindi na ibalik security kay Vice President. Just for the record, ma'am. Thank you, thank you.
Madam Chair.
Madam Vice President, go ahead, please.
Yes, thank you. I agree with Senator Bato de la Rosa. Huwag na natin pahirapan yung mga police personnel dahil kaibigan nila ako. Ibalik lang natin sila sa mga pamilya nila.
Thank you. Actually, Senator Tolentino is the Vice Chair for the Committee of the DILG for this budget season, Vice Chair Finance. So I would like you to ask the PNP Chief what led to that decision, because also part of that is, you know, if it's a political decision, I think that would not be fair also. But knowing that you're in the capable hands of the AFP is also reassuring. But this has to be raised.
Definitely, Madam Chair, this will be asked as a policy question to be directed to the Chief PNP.
Madam Chair,
Senator Garitano.
Yeah, just because we're on security, Madam Vice President, could you indulge me just one last question lang? Ang DOTR or NAIA ba nagsulat, explain at nag-apologize na sa inyo dun sa CCTV, hindi pa?
Senator Alan Peter Cayetano, thank you. Hindi, sir. Ang nangyari kasi dito, itong tao na ito apparently is assigned doon sa NAIA. Ang tao na ito is a media person na assigned permanently, I think, sa NAIA because this is the second time na nilabas niya yung istorya sa mga anak ko. Yung una, when I left for Singapore, year 2021. Wala naman akong problema doon. Ang aking problema lang is itong tao na ito, nilalabas niya pati yung information na kasama ko yung mga anak ko. Alam namin kung sino siya. We have footage na kumukuha siya ng cellphone footage. Ang sinasabi ko lang doon sa aking statement ay dapat siguro i-beef up ng NAIA ang security nila dahil may tao doon sa boarding lounge na hindi pasahero at hindi employee ng gobyerno at hindi employee ng NAIA. Yun yung sinasabi ko. If you want to have a world-class airport, dapat world-class din yung security natin. Hindi siya pasahero.
And in certain areas, bawal talaga, di ba? Sa immigration, dun sa may... there are certain areas na bawal kumuha. The reason I ask it, Madam Vice President, is yun nga, yung minsan kasi nasa-sensationalize, nagkakampihan, but nakakalimutan yung point eh. So I don't know when it started, kung 2010, 2013, but I remember, Senator Risa, nung nagra-rally tayo, nung anti-GMA, di ba? Sa rally ka lang makakita ng police na may camera, na may phone or camera, nakukunan tayo. But ngayon, actually, pag landing mo sa airport, if you take a car or a chopper, parang SOP na ng police, nakunan ng picture. Minsan, tinesting ko sila. Sabi ko, selfie na lang, sama kayo. Hindi. So I don't know, given the situation na nangyari sa inyo, na pati pamilya. As you said, no? Like ako, sanay naman ako kunan ng picture, whether they love me or hate me. That's why they want to get a picture. Minsan, pinapalitan yung lumabas dun sa 10,000 dun sa Rockwell. Actually, pinalitan nila yung audio eh. So, lumabas pa sa TV. Baliktad. Sumisigaw na, idol ko si Alan. Pinalitan nila na minumura ako. Then yun yung lumabas. But the point is, just like the Vice President, what if you're with your kids? What if you're with your pamangkins? What if may nakipicture lang sa'yo? What if may kasabay ka lang sa aeroplano, sa fast craft, or sa ano... So, hindi ba, I don't know, Senator Bato, ikaw lang ang highest ranking PNP dito. Eh. Bakit ba may ganun? I mean, hindi ba sufficient naman? I didn't intend to ask you. I asked this
but
para matanong.
But I intend to answer.
Yeah.
But I intend to answer.
No, kasi my point of view naman is, if it's for the record, unang-una, pag sumakay ka ng helicopter or ng aeroplano, dapat talaga may manifest yon. Pag landing mo, nandun yung police, eyewitness ka naman, dapat isulat yon. So, if factually, pumunta yung Vice President sa aeroplano, sumakay sa papuntang Davao, factually naman, pwede mo isulat eh. Hindi mo naman kailangan ng project nga. Ang daming ghost. Ayaw kunan ng COA at saka ng DPWH ng cellphone. Nawawala yung project eh. Pero tao sa atin, yung security, parang medyo, yun nga, I find the problem. Baka we should really look into that.
I would like to also give my experience on that. What I noticed is, for example, we're a guest in a certain event or in a province, usually, without even us requesting, the local government will ask the PNP to assist a public figure. And the reason why they take pictures, and just like Senator Alan, I thought at first they wanted a selfie, but apparently it's to provide proof to their commanders that they render the service. Now, it's a different story if they just take a picture for the fun of it, to give, I don't know, for others, if in areas where, let's say, there's limited access. So that's...
But to that point, Madam Chair, wala akong problema na kunan mo eh. But yung storage at paanong gagamitin, given that, so for example, we're talking about security ngayon, di ba? Kung sa Secret Service nga, na pinaka-professional, na kahit Democrat o Republican, eh may congressional hearing ngayon dahil dun sa nakalusot kay ex-President Trump. Sa atin pa kaya na we try na walang politika sa PNP at saka sa AFP, pero nakikita naman natin kahit anong administrasyon, meron talagang tendency. So my point is, if they're there to keep their officials safe, is it actually safe? As the Vice President said, that nasa terminal ka na high security, meron may cellphone kumukuha, hindi naman pala empleyado. So wala naman silang pananagutan sa batas or sa airport. Ganun din sa atin, wherever we go. Pagka nag-bus ako papuntang Bicol, kung 8 hours yun, pupungas-pungas ka pa pagbaba mo. Kailangan mo siguruduhin na ano ka kasi may kukuha sa'yo. Then you don't know where that picture will go. You know, sometimes things happen for us to look into it. So I'm nalulungkot ako na yung na-involve yung pamilya ng ating Vice President, regardless no of whether we are for or against her politically. But I'm ano that this can get out of hand given the number of pictures, and yung DICT tumawag sa akin dahil sa Committee on Science and Technology, at sabi nga lang, grabe na ngayon yung hindi na katulad nung araw sa atin, Photoshop lang. Ngayon pati boses, yung AI, yung deepfake, di ba? Pwedeng, so pati video talagang pwedeng i-manipulate, no?
Kahit nga hindi ka nakunan eh, pwedeng lumabas na may picture. No, I, as public figures, we cannot really avoid having our picture taken. But the issue here is in an area that's restricted. So I think that the DOTR has to do their best effort to make sure that only authorized individuals are in certain areas, and that they also have to take care of their CCTV, whatever. I mean, unless it's for the interest of the public, the safety of our national security issue, they better be careful with the information that they are handling. Senator Bato, you're recognized.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. another issue na naman ito na sigurong i-raise natin ito pagdating sa budget hearing ng BI. Dahil nga, itong president, vice president natin na lalabas ng bansa, minumonitor nila. May nakuhang picture, pinalabas ang picture, pero yung wanted na si Alice Go, nakalabas ng bansa, hindi nila nakuha na picture. Anong klaseng mga government agency ito? Itong vice president natin na walang violation of law na ginawa, may malicious intent pa talaga na kinuha na picture, pinalabas at ginawang issue during the kwandaw, during the bagyo, ganun-ganun, ginawa ng political issue. Ngayon, ito ngayong si Alice Go na wanted ng may lumabas na warrant, hinahanap ng committee ni Senator Risa, nakalabas na kung walang kaabog-abog, hindi mo lang na-monitor nila. So parang wrong focus of priority itong mga tao natin sa airport. We have to ask them during the budget hearing, anong priority nila? Politika ba o yung mandato nila? That's all, Madam Chair.
Actually, I sympathize with our colleagues here na pinaghirapan talaga nila yung hearing dun sa POGO issue. Tapos walang parang kooperasyon sa mga, hindi ko naman sinilala lahat ha, dun sa imposible kasing makakaalis yun na walang otoridad na kasangkot. Diba? So anyway, that's another topic. So
Madam
just
Chair,
open that up during the budget hearing of the PNP.
Madam, just to put a conclusion, Madam Vice President, sa akin kasi po yung kaya ko bringing up po yun, Kasi iba po yung mali at iba yung hindi nila inaamin na mali. No, meaning dapat pagkalabas ng video na yon, nag-announce na kagad yung airport o yung picture, di ba, na we apologize to the public, to the vice president, because you're our vice president. I mean, whether they voted for you or not, President Marcos is our president, whether we voted for him or not. So, amin kayo eh. So, pag ginawa sa inyo, halimbawa, kung ginawa sa inyo yan sa ibang bansa, nagwawala na yung DFA, no? So, ang point ko, Madam Chair, wala ka kasing narinig ka agad from the airport that we apologize, we're investigating, we have new guidelines, etc. That's why tinulay ko dun sa police, because it could suddenly happen to an ordinary mayor, congressman, barangay captain if we're taking pictures everywhere. At ano, having said that, as you said, we're open naman. Wala naman tayo tinatago sa public. Baka gantihan ko na lang yung ibang police. Kukunan ko rin sila pag nasa fort sila. Kukunan ko rin sila ng kukunan ng picture.
Okay, I think there are no more questions. Senator Gatchalian is recognized. Do you have questions, sir, or just a message of support, perhaps?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I'm just here to express my support, my full support to the budget of the Vice President. Thank you.
Thank you. With no other questions,
I manifest the wholehearted approval of the greater number of the members of this committee, and that therefore it should be endorsed to the mother committee.
If that is a motion, Madam Chair, I second that motion.
Second, likewise.
Yeah.
Likewise.
Lagpas na sa second yung mga motion eh. Okay, the budget of the Office of the Vice President is now deemed submitted to plenary. This hearing is suspended.